Good morning. My name is Marco Castronuovo. I come from Italy. I work for the Italian Space Agency in the Deep Space Observation and Exploration Unit. Today I will talk about orbits and their properties, so orbital dynamics. I think we can start from the basics. The first thing is we can ask ourselves what keeps a spacecraft in orbit. Several centuries ago, one of the first scientists, Aristotle in Greece, insisted that heavy objects should fall faster than lighter objects. But it took several centuries to understand that this was not true. Galileo put this to test. We know that he made experiments from Pisa Tower, dropping objects, and the results was, of course, that all objects fall at the same rate. So what happens is that, of course, our observation is influenced by the presence of atmosphere, and it changes the way objects behave during their free fall. So given this, if, for example, we throw a baseball and we could drop a baseball from a given height, and we can throw another baseball horizontally from the same height exactly at the same time, which one do you think would hit the ground first? Of course, the right answer is that they will hit the ground at the same time. Now, if we threw this ball hard enough, we could use the Earth curvature to keep the ball flying. In fact, we know that every 8 kilometers, the Earth curves, or we can say drops, of 5 meters. So if we threw hard enough, this means we gave a sufficient velocity to our ball, we could have a continuous fall and the ball actually would stay orbiting around the Earth. So we can use this feature actually to throw objects into orbit. What is an orbit? An orbit is a path of a spacecraft or a natural body around another object or through space. Actually, orbit is used for a circular or elliptical path, so closed trajectories, while trajectory is preferred for open paths. An orbit can be specified by a state vector. So, for example, a set of 6 quantities, position and velocity of the spacecraft at some specified time. So we have 3 components of positions and 3 components of velocity. In particular, we can start considering Keplerian orbits. Keplerian orbits is a definition of orbits for which some assumptions are valid. First of all, gravity is the only force acting on the object. The second is that the central body is spherically symmetric, so that it can be assumed to be a point mass. The central body mass is much greater than the one of the satellite, so the satellite mass can be neglected. And last but not least, the central body and the satellite are the only 2 objects in the system. So this is a closed system with only 2 objects in it. So, starting from Newton's laws of motion, we can see how we derive the equations of motion in space. So we recall that first law of motion is that everybody will continue in its state of rest or uniform motion in a straight line, except it is forced to change the state by an impressed force. The second states that the rate of change of momentum is proportional to the impressed force and takes place in the line in which the force acts. And the third one states that action and reaction are equal or opposite. So, since momentum is the product of mass of a body and its velocity, the Newton's second law can be written in this way, where we can substitute for the acceleration its expression as a first derivative of velocity with respect to time, and also as a second derivative of position with respect to time, to times. Considering the law that is ruling the motion of the bodies, this is the Newton's universal gravitational law. And it expresses the force of attraction between two point masses, capital M and small m, separated by the distance r. The force is expressed by this expression, and as you see, the minus sign expresses the attraction between the two bodies. G is the universal gravitation constant, and the force is inversely proportional to the square of the distance. Of course, this expression is valid only for point masses. If we consider bodies with different shapes or not spherical symmetry, this has to be changed accordingly, and probably you can imagine there will be some integral of the body taking into account the shape of the body itself. So combining Newton's second law of motion with this law of gravitation, we obtain the two-body equation of motion that is closely approximating the motion of spacecraft in space and in the planets as well. And you see that we have the acceleration on the first hand side, and we have the Newton's universal gravitational force on the second side. What is important to notice is that these equations do not contain any properties of the spacecraft. In fact, the mass of the spacecraft cancels out in the preceding two equations. This means, in fact, as we know, that the free fall is equal for all bodies, regardless of their mass. We can also recall Kepler's laws. Kepler's Dutch astronomer who derived these laws from astronomical observations. So he applied these laws to planets. The first one says that all planets travel in elliptical paths with the Sun at one of the focus. The second, that the radius vector from the Sun to a planet sweeps equal areas in equal times. And the third one is the ratio of the square of the period of revolution of a planet to the cube of its semi-major axis is the same for all planets revolving around the Sun. Of course, these laws apply also if we substitute satellite for planet and Earth for Sun. So also for artificial satellites around the Earth, they apply. Another important aspect about orbital dynamics is the fact that gravity is a conservative force field. So mechanical energy is constant. It is saved during the process. we have that the total mechanical energy and the, that is given by the sum of kinetic energy and potential energy is constant. And this applying to the orbital motion leads to the so-called vis viva equation. We can express the total mechanical energy, in fact, as the sum of kinetic energy and potential energy. And this equals to a constant in which it appears this mu parameter is the so-called gravitational parameter, is the product of the universal gravitational constant by the mass of the central body, and this parameter A that we will see is the semi-major axis of the orbit. So first law of Kepler states more in general that orbits are conic sections, so their path can be seen as the intersection of a plane and a cone. So we can have objects moving on circular orbits, on elliptic orbits, parabolic or hyperbolic. In fact, I must underline that some of these are actually just hypothetical paths. They are kind of ideal states. In fact, a circular orbit in reality is never exactly attained, as well as parabolic. From a geometrical point of view, an ellipse is defined by two points known as foci, and the ellipse is the locus of points where the sum of the distances from each point on the ellipse to the foci is constant and is exactly two times the semi-major axis A that we mentioned before. One of the foci is the center of mass or barycenter of the two objects, while the other one is only a geometrical point and is empty in space. The shape of an ellipse is uniquely specified by single parameters, such as the ratio of the semi-major and semi-minor axis. And the parameter that is normally used to specify this shape is the eccentricity E. The eccentricity also can be a convenient ratio to parameterize all conic sections, so we can classify the conic sections on the basis of ellipse. For example, we see that the circular orbit has an eccentricity equals to zero, while E-ellipse has an eccentricity between zero and one. The parabolic orbit is has an eccentricity equals to one, and hyperbola is greater than one. As I said before, you can see that circular and parabolic orbits are ideal trajectories. In fact, you will never obtain an eccentricity that is perfectly zero, but you will always have some residual value that will set it as a, an ellipse with a very low eccentricity. The circle and the ellipse are closed bounds orbits that continuously repeat. Instead, parabola and hyperbola are open, so they are trajectories that are traveled only once by the object. And they are traveled especially by comets, or by spacecrafts when they travel in interplanetary missions, so they move from one center of gravity to another one. Kepler's second law is a way of restating the conservation of angular momentum. In fact, angular momentum is proportional to the magnitude of radius vector, times the perpendicular component of the velocity. This means that satellites have a tangential velocity that is different along the orbit. You will see that satellite is much faster near when passing near the center of mass, while it slows down where it's far from it. This exactly is stated by the second law of Kepler. The third law applies only to circular and elliptical orbits, and it relates the orbital period and its semi-major axis. In fact, from the third Kepler's law, we can derive a formula to compute the period of revolution of a satellite around around the Earth, for example. To do this, we can equate the centrifugal force that I remind you is just an apparent force, is a force that appears only when we are in the frame and the reference frame of the moving body. So equating centrifugal force and the force of gravity that supplies centripetal force, where mu is the gravitational parameter, is given by the product of the universal gravitational constant times the mass of the central body. For the Earth, this has a specific value that is important to keep in mind, 398,604 cubic kilometers over square seconds, and is important also to keep in mind the dimensions of this constant. And m, small m, is the mass of the satellite. So equating these two forces, we can compute the period of revolution as the circumference traveled divided by the velocity. And if we substitute the value of the velocity given from the preceding equation, we obtain what I said before, a given ratio between the square of the period of revolution and the radius, the cube of the radius of this orbit.